Americans waste nearly 40% of our food. That's like buying 5 bags of groceries from the grocery store and then instantly just tossing 2 of them in the trash. Or when you get 5 bananas, you eat the first 3 pretty quickly, but then you let those last 2 just get a little bit too brown and you keep telling yourself you're gonna eat them tomorrow, but then the moment comes when you throw those 2 lonely bananas in the trash. Food waste is a huge problem, and American households are some of the worst culprits. According to the Food and Agriculture Organization, food waste is responsible for 8% of greenhouse gas emissions. If food waste were a country, it would be the 3rd biggest contributor to greenhouse gases after the United States and China. That's a pretty big deal. And not only that, but I used to think that if I threw that brown banana in the trash, that it would decompose in a landfill and become one with the earth, and in some way I was providing back to the soil. But when you throw those bananas into a landfill, most of the time they don't decompose and they actually become an even bigger problem to the environment. So it's really a double-edged sword. So I pretty quickly became absolutely obsessed with this problem, and it set me on a mission to try and solve it. But first, before I get into that, I want to talk a little bit about my backstory. Growing up, my dad was an incredibly hardworking businessman who had an Italian sausage factory in the heart of Chicago. You could call him the Sausage King of Chicago if you guys are any Ferris Bueller's Day Off fans. And when I was a kid, I wanted to become the next Sausage King of Chicago. I was so passionate about the family business. I loved trying out different spice blends, visiting my dad at the office, the scents, the paprika, the garlic, the meatballs. It was absolutely beautiful and delicious. I'd sit in the kitchen with my grandma Rosie and just watch her work her magic. It was a part of the family and it was a big part of me, and it's something that I really wanted to do for the longest time. Until I was about 19 years old and my perspective on the food industry completely changed. When I was 19 years old, I was a college dropout and I was living off of ramen and egg sandwiches, leftover sausage, and if I was ever feeling fancy, I would make my famous grape reduction with a pureed nut spread on top of a brioche bun, also called the peanut butter and jelly sandwich. In other words, I was eating crap and I honestly didn't really care at the time because I was feeling good. I wasn't really concerned about my health. But this all changed when I witnessed one of the most incredible transformations. One of my best friends lost over 100 pounds by switching to a nutrient-dense plant-based diet. This completely changed the way that I look at food. You know, I was blessed with a fast metabolism, so I was eating unhealthy, but it didn't show on the outside. But this made me wonder, what kind of damage was all that Italian sausage and ramen doing to the insides of my body, and how would this affect me in the long term? So this became really concerning for me, and I set out on a journey to learn a little bit more about the food industry. Fast forward a couple years, and I started a cooking show called Trying Vegan with Mario, where I wasn't actually a vegan at all. I was just somebody who was curious to learn a little bit more about plant-based food because I'd done so much research. I had read books, but I was a stingy eater. I love my peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. So in order for me to actually really get into healthy food, I had to learn some tips and tricks in the kitchen. So on Trying Vegan with Mario, I would invite expert chefs, nutritionists, and people who knew a lot about the plant-based diet to come and teach me their best recipes. So on season 1 of my show, I had the ultimate vegan bodybuilder, Brian Turner. This guy is just absolutely shredded, a competitor, and he came and he taught me how vegans can actually get a lot of protein by eating a lot of grains. He taught me about quinoa, eating more beans, eating lots of rice, and eating lots of healthy plant-based foods that could also help support muscle growth in the process. Then after that, I had Dr. Joel Fuhrman, one of the most world-renowned experts at plant-based nutrition, and he is a master at reversing diseases caused by the foods that we're eating. Dr. Fuhrman showed me how you could reverse heart disease, osteoporosis, and some of the most chronic illnesses that are responsible for most of the deaths in the United States just by switching the way that you eat. So this was absolutely mind-blowing to me, and I would get to actually visit with these people and see firsthand the effects of the plant-based food that they were eating. And of course, in the process, it made me really think about everything I was doing working in the meat industry and how I might want to change the approach that I was making to food. The evidence was pretty clear. Eating plant-based could be a lot better for your health. Made me feel a little bit sad because, you know, I loved my Italian sausage for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, but I learned, you know, that might not be the healthiest thing for my heart. So it was time for me to make a change. And so my journey continued to grow and open up different doors of opportunity. So I learned that plant-based food could be better for your health. But then I started to learn a little bit more about how eating plant-based food could actually be better for the environment as well. I had one of my friends, Jonathan, on one of my episodes, and Jonathan has discovered this magical bean called the tepary bean, which is one of the most resilient plants in the United States. The tepary bean actually grows in the desert and requires practically zero water to grow. And this is key because as the climate rises, as temperatures rise, we need to have crops that can survive these changing conditions. So the tepary bean is mighty and resilient, could grow in the desert and could weather those types of storms. It's also absolutely packed with protein. And one of the things that Jonathan focuses on the most in his business is delivering tepary beans locally, limiting the amount of distance for distribution, and really thinking about the environment with every decision that he makes. And this is when I learned about the purpose and the intent of entrepreneurship, and how some of these people are so deep-rooted in this passion to make a positive change that they don't compromise for the profits, but they do it for the benefits of themselves and for the planet. So this continued to snowball into this effect where I was learning more and more about how eating different types of food could have a lower impact on the environment. So the next thing I learned about is the perky portobello mushroom. These things are absolutely delicious. They have an incredible flavor, but did you know that they are also some of the most resourceful foods to grow? So it takes 1.8 gallons of water to grow 1 pound of portobello mushrooms. Can you guys guess how much water it takes to grow 1 pound of beef? Over 1,000 gallons of water to grow 1 pound of beef. So this, again, mind-blowing to me. I had no idea that there was such a discrepancy on how much energy is used to grow animal-based products versus plant-based products. And even on top of that, to grow cattle in the first place requires to grow so many plant-based products. So majority of the soy and the corn in the United States is actually fed to cattle. So some people will come up with the argument, something I've been facing plenty of times, is that if you're eating plants, you're just gonna have to grow more plants, but it will actually grow less plants by eating more plants, which is one of the most interesting aspects of this whole thing. And so for the past 3 to 4 years, I've become a master vegan chef in the kitchen, and I follow two very important principles. One, of course, eating plant-based local ingredients that require less water to grow and less use on the environment. And then number two, this is one of the keys, is just simply not wasting any food. It seems like the most obvious thing in the world. So I wanna give you guys a couple of my favorite tips to eat healthier plant-based food, to eat more sustainably, and also to taste some stuff that's delicious, because to be honest, that's the only way we're gonna eat it in the first place. So now let's bring it back to the humble banana. These things just fit so perfectly inside of your hand, and they come pre-packed with a wrapper that is so easy to make them store in your pocket, or if you're ever being chased by a toad on a go-kart, you could throw it behind you and it becomes a weapon. But in all seriousness, come on, bananas are one of the most versatile foods on the planet. So let's talk about some banana recipes. One thing you could do with overly ripe browning bananas, instead of throwing them in the trash, is the browner the banana becomes, the more flavorful, the more sweet and full of sugar it becomes. So those browner bananas are so delicious for your dessert recipes. They're great for your banana breads. They're great for your smoothies. And I want to tell you guys a great way that you could use bananas to make your own homemade granola. So to make your own homemade granola, you just need one banana, 1 cup of oats, you mash them together, you put them on a tray, you throw those in the oven, 350 degrees for about 30 minutes, and you have a delicious granola. If you want to level up your granola, you could add nuts, you could add seeds, you could add dry fruit, take it whichever way you want to go. But just make sure that you're incorporating that delicious banana and we're getting the most out of it. Now, another thing that I discovered that I absolutely love to do with bananas is I found a way to use the peel. So normally you take the banana peel, like I said, you toss it behind you, you take care of the toad that's chasing you on a go-kart. But no, we're gonna save our peels. We're actually gonna use them for something really good for the environment. So what you can do is you can dry out your peels. If you live in a desert area, you leave them outside and they're gonna dry and dehydrate. Or you could do it in your oven, or you could do it in a dehydrator. What we're gonna do is we're gonna dry out those banana peels and then you grind those up into a powder. And that is just jam-packed with vitamins and nutrition and loads of potassium. Potassium is one of the most important things for the soil. So we could take that ground up banana peel, that potassium, drizzle it into our plants, sprinkle a little bit here and there on your fern inside your house and what you got going outside. And if you mix 1 tablespoon of that banana powder with about 6 ounces of water, and then you drizzle that on your plants, you're gonna be providing your plants with a delicious fertilizer. So now we're taking the banana peel and we're leveling it up and we're putting it back into the earth and we're bringing more value back to the soil, which is so important. So with all that being said, these are just a couple of my favorite tips for how you guys can cook better in the kitchen, how you could reduce your food waste, taste delicious food. So the next time that you're at the grocery store, really think about the purchases that you're making. Think about that statistic that we waste 40% of the food that we purchase. Maybe try buying 40% less and using 100% of it. That could be one of those small steps that you could take with the rest of us to improve the impact that we have on the environment. Thank you so much.